Let's start at the very beginning. A very good place to start. When you read, you begin with
A, B, C.
When you sing, you begin with Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi. The first three notes just happen to be Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi.
From its ancient fortresses to its stunning vistas, the city of Salzburg hardly seems to have changed since director Robert Wise, his team, his cast, and I arrived here to make our film version of Rodgers and Hammerstein's The Sound of Music. But a great deal has changed in the half a century since our movie opened in 1965. For one thing, its success created an indelible link between the film and the city in which its story took place. And now, here I am again in Salzburg, not only to revisit some of our film's most famous locations and recall that experience, but also to gain perspective and ponder. What is it about The Sound of Music that has made it such an enormous success? Why does it mean so much to so many people? And how does our film, based on a true story, continue to echo here in the hills and the squares of Salzburg?
So do ra fa mi do re. So do la fa ti la so fa ti do. So do.
It is 50 years since The Sound of Music premiered on movie screens, which to me is absolutely mind-boggling. I had seen the Broadway show with Mary Martin, and it's no secret that before making the film, I did wonder if a movie version might just perhaps be too sentimental. Think about it, children, mountains, music, and nuns. But by the time I arrived here in Salzburg for filming, I knew I never needed to worry again. Thanks in great part to our director, Robert Wise, a superb script by Ernest Lehman, and a cast with whom I still remain friends, including Christopher Plummer, who brought such a welcome astringency to his role.
I don't wish you to discuss my children in this manner.
Well, you've got to hear from someone. You're never home long enough
to
know them.
I don't want to hear any more from you about my children.
I know you don't, but you've got to.
At the time, my career in cinema was just beginning. I'd only made two films before The Sound of Music, and neither had been released. So I was having a wonderful time playing and making movies. It's only in recent years, while writing about my life before The Sound of Music, that I came to realize how much I have in common with Maria in terms of our favorite things and the unexpected ways in which music changed our lives. Standing on these steps brings back so many memories of filming the song Do Re Mi. That song reminds us that it only takes a handful of notes, seven to be precise, to create the most memorable music. And in the actual version of the story we told, it took just one person to put these events into motion. The real Maria von Trapp was born exactly 30 years before me, near Vienna, only 950 miles away from my home in England. For both Maria and me, nature was a passion from a very early age. For me, it meant boat rides with my father, Ted Wells, on the River Thames, which flowed past my hometown of Walton-on-Thames. And for Maria, nature meant walks through the hillsides and the mountains of Austria, especially when she needed an escape from her unhappy home after losing both parents by the age of six. I think I understand some of what Maria must have felt growing up as I did in a family that was full of change. But as a girl, I discovered something that transformed my life saved my life, really, just as it did Maria's. It was the joy of making music. At age 18, Maria made a sudden and surprising decision to become a nun. Apparently, she made many sudden decisions in her early life, and perhaps this choice was made because she needed to go somewhere that felt safe. It brought her here, to the oldest surviving religious home for women in the Western world, Nonnberg Abbey. When our film's production team first visited Nonnberg on a scouting trip, their report was less than glowing. One of them dismissed it as a drab, uninteresting pile of stucco. Not a fair description at all. And fortunately, Robert Wise saw something special here in the calm exterior of Maria's actual home. When I arrived to film this scene at Nonnberg in May of 1964, I could feel a sense of tranquility that must have so appealed to the woman I was playing. Someone who, like most of us at her age, was full of confusion, yet excitement, frustration, yet hope. I remember that our cinematographer, Ted McCord, kept the lighting very low when I stood inside the Abbey gate. But as I stepped outside, he raised the light to suggest a warm ray of sunshine, as if the world was welcoming Maria. Visiting Nonnberg, one can't help but wonder, what do today's residents here think about the Sound of Music and the impact it has had on their quiet home? I am speaking to the Mother Abbess, Perpetua Hildenberg. Reverend Mother, how many tourists each day do you think come here because of the Sound of Music?
Eine unzählige Menge, und zwar aus der ganzen Welt. Es ist nicht nur Amerikaner, sondern aus der ganzen Welt.
In our movie, Georg and Maria are married in Monse, but in actual fact, they were married here in your church, right?
Ja, ganz genau, das ist richtig. Sie haben hier geheiratet, sind auch über diesen Weg geschritten.
And how many people of the Order of St. Benedict actually live here at the Abbey?
Jetzt sind es 22 Nonnen, die wir hier am Nonnberg leben. Als ich eintrat, das war 1971, waren es noch über 50.
I think the Sound of Music helped a lot of young ladies to go into the church. I have heard this story, yes?
Ja, das stimmt schon. Wir hatten mal eine Anfrage, eine Postulantin aus Addis Abeba, aus Äthiopien. Aha. Und die hatte den Film Sound of Music gesehen. Die war da bei der UNO angestellt und die hat sich also eingebildet. Die war so fasziniert von dem Film, dass sie gedacht hat, da tritt sie ein. In dieses Kloster ist sie gekommen und man hat sie auch aufgenommen.
Is there much singing in this order, in the Benedictine?
Ja, wir singen viel und singen auch gerne.
When the Lord closes a door, somewhere he opens a window. That quote has been true in so many lives, including my own. I've changed careers three or four times in my life, from vaudeville to theater to film to writing books. And each time that window revealed something exciting and magical. After three rather tempestuous years at Nonnberg, Maria left the Abbey to start a new life as a governess. And I can guess how she must have felt when her talents took her away from the calm of Nonnberg and into the boisterous Villa von Trapp and those seven children.
Oh, help.
In The Sound of Music, Maria's journey takes her here, to the Villa von Trapp. But in reality, this beautiful entry did not lead to the home of a captain with seven children. For over a century, it's been one of Salzburg's most respected music academies, the Mozarteum. And it's fitting that this location, like so much of Salzburg and our film, celebrates music. I'm talking to Herr Max Banker, who was the manager of this beautiful institution when we were actually filming here. So I met you and I met your son, who was how old then?
5 years.
Only 5 years old. Well, I won't ask how old he is now. But he was a very sweet little boy.
A student from Frohnburg gave him a rose and told him, please go to Julie Andrews and bring her the rose.
Oh.
It was just over there.
Oh. And this little five-year-old boy came up.
Do you remember?
And handed me the rose. Yes, yeah. Yes. Tell me, Herr Banker, why do you think it is that so many great musicians came from Austria? We have two Haydns, a Mozart, Schubert. What is it about Austria that makes such great musicians?
I had one impression with the students of Frohnburg. Went out in the landscape, in the valleys, up in the mountains. And someone told me, if I walk here, I hear Schubert.
When we were here filming so long ago, I didn't have much time to go anywhere really, but one day I went to an afternoon concert in a beautiful room and they were playing Mozart. It was so pure and so beautiful because it was the music that belonged to the place in the room where it might have been played. Suddenly, I really discovered Mozart and realized how beautiful that music is. It had never really hit me quite as much as it did that day. After first finding fame in Salzburg, the Trapp family singers would perform over 2,000 concerts around the world over 17 often very exhausting years. I believe that at times there may have been a little rebellion from some members of the family, and probably rightly so. A life spent constantly performing and constantly traveling is not exactly an easy one. And for me, traveling has made home all the more important. I'm actually told it's the very first word I ever uttered. And that word still holds a special power for me. It means a place where I can go back to being my real self and to spend time with the family and friends that I love. In The Sound of Music, home becomes synonymous with the Villa von Trapp, a place that never looked more beautiful than during the scene shot here for our film.
Oh, Captain, you're home!
The 18th century palace of Schloss Leopoldskron provided our movie with this gorgeous lakeside terrace. And the palace's Venetian room, it hasn't changed a bit since our production designer, Boris Levin, used it as the model for the Von Trapp ballroom. You see, although most of our exteriors were filmed in Salzburg, interiors were mostly filmed at 20th Century Fox Studios in Los Angeles. I marvel at how well Boris reimagined this gorgeous room on a Hollywood soundstage. I mean, it's such a beautiful place, and he just somehow made it even grander and bigger in the movie. Returning to Leopoldskron, I can't help but be reminded of some of our film's most touching scenes, the ones in which Maria, the captain, and the children truly become a family. The idea of family, I think, is one of the keys to The Sound of Music's success. After all, who among us doesn't yearn for unconditional love and acceptance? Especially from one's family.
My heart wants to sigh like a chime that flies.
And in the film, Maria helps guide the captain back to something he lost after the death of his first wife. I'm here with my great friend, Bert Finck from the Rodgers and Hammerstein office. And nobody, I mean nobody, knows more about the history of Rodgers and Hammerstein, their families, their shows, than Bert. And you want to know anything?
go ask him, and I have, haven't I?
Yes, it's amazing. I mean, here we are at one of the iconic scenes from The Sound of Music.
I know.
Does it feel like being back here in what filmgoers think is the Von Trapp's backyard?
It's great. It's such a beautiful setting, and I think probably of all of them, this was my favorite. I've always loved water, and there it is, that beautiful lake, even though I had to go in it.
Jump in it once or twice.
But I did.
There's so many iconic moments filmed here. So many of the family scenes happened here.
Yeah, they did.
And family is such an important theme.
Yeah, it is. Well, I guess it's really what the film is all about, keeping the family safe, keeping them united, and rekindling the love in the family.
Maria is the dream, you know, stepmom for so many.
She is, and so many people have told me that they at least once or twice said to their mums, you know, why can't I have either Mary Poppins or Maria Von Trapp for my mum? And, well, I'm... gosh, if they only knew, really.
Have some mums come to you, some mothers come to you and said, you know, you give us a lot to live up to or,
yes.
or to aspire to?
Yes, well, it has to be perfect on film.
Yeah. There was a Sound of Music family here with your film team, but you brought real family with you when you were filming here in 64.
Well, one of the members of my family, yes, my little girl. She was then only 18 months old. Tiny little Emma, and she was adorable.
Did she come to the set when you were filming?
Yes, she did occasionally. A set like this, she would be here. And Bob Wise, very sweetly, drew her onto his lap one day. I thought it was the kindest thing he could do. This little girl watching the filming and wondering what the heck Mommy was doing, and he just drew her onto his knee behind the camera and sat with her. And it melted my heart, it did. Now, of course, she's the woman with whom I write all my stories. And if anybody had told me when she was this high that she and I would be looking across a table one day at each other as equal women, writing, laughing, drinking endless cups of tea.
Well, it's interesting that in the story, because there are so many parallels, Maria and Liesl become friends, really. And you and Emma, it's not only mother-daughter. You are friends.
Very much so, yeah.
And you work together. It's amazing then for you to think that little girl who sat on Bob Wise's lap
I know.
Here...
If anybody had told me then, I just couldn't have conceived of it.
I know that Emma wrote a wonderful tribute to you. I think it was a Mother's Day tribute.
Yeah, I had no idea she was going to do it. And it was a gift and it was a surprise.
Was it a surprise for you? I know it began, her sparkle remains undimmed. She was up at 6 a.m. each school day, cooking us a good protein breakfast,
yes.
No matter how late she'd worked the night before. Whether it's a Band-Aid, a button hook, or a hug, she gives freely and generously of everything she has and is. The love and support she gives is endless in abundance.
Oh, isn't that nice? Gets me quite teary. Just as the sights and the music of Salzburg inspired our team during shooting, it's fascinating to see how The Sound of Music continues to influence this city. For example, in 1964, we filmed the Lonely Goatherd sequence a long, long way from Salzburg at 20th Century Fox. I loved the idea to add marionettes to the screen version of the song, a choice that I'm told was inspired by an early scouting trip by the filmmakers to the celebrated Salzburg Marionette Theater.
Doe, a deer, a female deer, Ray, a drop of golden sun. Me, a name I call myself, far, a long, long way to run.
Would you believe that while filming in Salzburg, I never came to this wonderful place? Well, I guess I was a bit busy, and the only sightseeing I did was of the places where we were shooting. Back then, the Salzburg Marionette Theater based most of its performances on music from the great operas. But in 2007, the theater made a special exception. They created an exquisite miniature production of The Sound of Music. Since then, it's toured the world, and it's proven to be one of the theater's most popular attractions.
When you
I'm sitting with Barbara Heuberger, who is the managing director of the Salzburg Marionette Theater. Barbara, tell me, you do now a full production of The Sound of Music, right?
Yes.
And since when?
Since 2007.
Wow.
Yeah.
How long has the Marionette Theatre been going?
100 years.
100 years?
Yes, it's quite a time.
I thought we were special because The Sound of Music is 50th yes. year. But 100 is really something.
Yes, it started 1913, and it was founded by a sculptor, Anton Eicher. Mm-hmm. And it was since 2012 in the hands of the family. And I have the honor to proceed.
To proceed after that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Gretel, a prince! A prince on the bridge of a castle, moat heard lay, odele, odele.
Men on a road with a load to tote heard lay, odele, odele.
In the movie of The Sound of Music, there are the seven children and also myself, and we work the puppets. How many puppeteers do you have?
We have 10.
10. Yeah, well, that sounds better. It was exhausting to do this in the movie.
Yeah, but it's exhausting for the puppeteers, too.
Yeah, I know, crossing over each other and making room for each other. Yeah,
it's very tight up there, so they really have to...
They have to love each other very much, I think.
So that's true, yeah.
Do, me, 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 so, so, ray, fa, fa.
In our film of The Sound of Music, of course, I sing about my favorite things.
Cream-colored ponies and crisp apple strudels, doorbells and sleigh bells and schnitzel with noodles.
You actually show that in your production, right?
Yes, yes. We have special puppets, yeah. These are little dishes with apple
those things
strudel
on it,
and schnitzel with noodles.
That must be so charming.
And they have legs, so... If it's coming in, and you open it,
Then... So it makes the audience laugh a little bit,
yes,
smile.
They like it very much.
It must have to be quick, because the song goes quite quickly.
Yes,
yeah?
Yes, yes.
And yours are carved wood, right?
Yes, all are wood. Some, of course, are molded, because seven children, we needed 21.
Oh, my
because gosh.
Because of changes of costume.
Right.
It's a real art.
It is an art, yes. It's like an instrument. To learn an instrument,
yes.
To manipulate the puppets, it's quite a time to learn it.
When we shot the marionette scene in the film, I didn't have to do very much because really they were more interested in filming the puppets.
Yeah.
And so I had to look like I knew what I was doing, but I really don't. So tell me a little bit.
You put down your hand a little bit.
Yeah.
So that she's touching
on the floor.
Yeah.
All right.
And this is... For moving the legs.
The legs. And this is the hands
then.
And
the hands.
Yep.
And this is a thread to put them together.
Oh, so if I wish to embrace the man that was my husband, I would just go with... How do I get hold of that?
I'm here.
Yes. There.
Here, Maria.
Hello. Hello. And do your puppeteers take a bow afterwards, I hope?
Yes,
they do.
They do.
Where do you see them? I mean, how do you take that
here
out?
We have a mirror.
I see.
And they're standing up above us.
Mm-hmm.
High on a hill was a lonely goatherd, lady, oh, lady, oh, lady. Loud was the voice of the lonely goatherd, lady, oh, lady, oh, loo.
And at the end, for a curtain called The Puppets Move Puppets.
Oh, gosh. In the last half a century, the residents of this city have become very used to visitors wanting to know all about our film. In fact, our movie is among the top reasons that tourists come to Salzburg. And whether traveling on your own or taking the official Sound of Music tour given by Panorama Tours,
It's easy to feel that you've been transported back in time and into our film.
It's so timeless. Even going through the city today, it looks exactly like it did when the movie was filmed.
We look forward to this trip very much because I grew up with The Sound of Music. I watched the movie as a child and together with my children, and I'm looking forward to watching it again with my grandchildren in the future.
I love Julie Andrews. I love the scenery. I love the songs.
I think the movie caters to audience of all ages, from the very young to the old. It caters to the entire family. And you can always sit together and enjoy the movie together.
I like the gazebo. 16 going on 17, but it's my anthem.
Even one of our iconic sets, built by 20th Century Fox, has found a new home in Salzburg. This reconstruction of the Von Trapp's gazebo, as seen in the film, was brought to the gardens of Hellbrunn Palace, where it is visited by hundreds of people every day. It's a delightful case of life imitating art, imitating life.
Now, Bert, I know that we shot our gazebo scene, the love scene, in Los Angeles, and there wasn't one, to the best of my knowledge, here in Salzburg. Well, how come this is here right now?
Yes and no.
Okay.
There are actually two gazebos.
Okay.
So you worked on a gazebo in Los Angeles that was taken apart and you could light it certain ways, and that's where you did Something Good and Charmy and Dan 16 going on 17. But first, the Fox team here in Salzburg built a gazebo that sat on the grounds at Leopoldskron by the lake.
Yeah.
That you used in some of the...
As a background shot.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And after you all left, you left that gazebo behind as sort of a gift to the city of Salzburg.
I see. So,
and then the city elders thought, well, let's move it to a public garden where everybody can enjoy it. And now Sound of Music fans make a pilgrimage. They always come to the gazebo here in Hellbrunn.
Gosh.
I thought I just might find you here.
Was there something you wanted?
Hmm? No. Sit down, please.
You know, when you think about the gazebo, to me, the word is romance. This is sort of where romance happened.
Well, it is in the movie, isn't it? Not only Maria and Georg, but Liesl and her beau, and they dance in this gazebo. Mm-hmm.
With you and Chris, of course, Something Good, which is that wonderful, we think it was the last shot that you did together.
But yes, I think it is.
There's a wonderful dialogue that people overlooked, an Ernest Lehman dialogue. That
oh,
leads
you mean
into,
before we actually yes. walk into the gazebo?
Does that, do you remember doing that scene?
Yeah, I certainly do. I remember Chris being so adorable because he says something about, well, it was all wrong when you went away and then it'd be all wrong when you go again.
Nothing was the same when you were away, and it'll be all wrong again after you leave. And I just thought perhaps you might change your mind.
And he did it almost like a little boy. I mean, he couldn't say that he was in love or anything like that at that moment. And it was just so enchantingly spoken by Chris, and it made my heart feel so warm.
It is a beautiful scene.
Showed what a wonderful actor he was and how invested he was in his character, you know.
Didn't you once say in an interview that you always fall a little bit in love with your leading man?
Well, one does with all of the great guys.
Right.
I mean, because they are all delicious and one's worked with some wonderful people. Mm-hmm. The nice thing is that Chris and I have stayed such good friends for so long. I mean, it's as if we never had any intervening time when we get together. We're just as silly and have just as good a time. One of my favorite locations from the film can also be reached by tour bus or taxi, magnificent Monsey Abbey, north of Salzburg. The Basilica here at Monsey was the very first location we used in Salzburg on April the 23rd, 1964. It was here that we filmed the wedding of Maria and Georg with the help of 600 locals, and we asked them if they would be kind enough to dress in their Tyrolean finest, and they did. It was all shot in a single day, a very long single day.
I have the pleasure of sitting here with Father Ernest Wageneder, who is the parish priest of this beautiful St. Michael's Basilica. And this is where we shot the beautiful wedding scene for The Sound of Music. And I hear that a lot of people come here to get married.
I'm very happy because you brought me with the film The Sound of Music really a lot of work.
Oh, really?
Yes. For example, on Saturday, we have 8 ceremonies for the wedding. And
eight?
That's really...
Eight wedding ceremonies?
Yes, and that's really hard. But I like it because that's a festivity of love.
And was it because of The Sound of Music that they asked, or was it a little bit half and half?
I think that Sound of Music is very important also for the ceremonies of the weddings for St. Michael and Monse. But I think so many people are coming because they would like to see the place, the original place where the wedding
is shown in our movie.
You stayed there 50 years ago. And,
and
the people fall in love. Yes, yes, but the people fall in love also today. A lot of people can remember the day where you filmed the Sound of Music at the wedding.
You,
yes, and for the people it was very beautiful.
The whole church looked quite amazing. Yeah. Yeah. And they were patient and kind. And I remember also that director Robert Wise did an extraordinary thing, which I think is one of the most beautiful shots. Not only did you see me coming along this beautiful aisle, but he put his cameras along the side and you saw me in profile.
Yeah.
So each beautiful archway on the side here was captured. And it's a magnificent shot, it really is. He really, I think he did the Basilica proud. One day, during this exciting, chaotic adventure, I came face to face with the very woman I was playing on screen, Baroness Maria von Trapp. On May the 22nd, 1964, the real Maria made a totally unexpected visit to our filming location in Residenzplatz. I was quite nervous that she was there, but she welcomed me and we bonded instantly. "I'm glad you're playing Maria as a tomboy," she said, "because that's the way I was. Growing up with three brothers, I had to be a tomboy. But I'm certainly not alone in relating to Maria's story. To this day, people from around the world share with me the messages they take from her life and from our film."
Great fact I picked up this week. The Sound of Music has been translated into over 30 languages.
Well, I've heard that, but I never knew it was as much as 30.
Amazing. Have people told you over the years what this film meant to them from all parts of the world?
Yes, they surely have. Mostly what people say is the joy that they felt watching it. I get a lot of comments from students saying it's the film that made them want to be a singer or to go into theater or become an actress.
The film is so much about art and music.
It is. And you don't see it that often in movies, do you?
Right.
You really don't. I think that's why it was such a joy to do, because everything that one feels inside about music is there on the screen.
So do la fa mi do re. So do la ti do re do.
Good.
It's interesting. The film, of course, opened in 65. From 65 to 72, it was the top grossing film of all time.
Is that true?
Absolutely. And what was happening in America, it was, we went from Vietnam to Watergate. Those were turbulent, rough times.
Yes.
And that was a film everyone wanted to see.
There again, there you are. And you know why? Because it was gentle and loving.
So people draw from it. They see it.
And also, every 7 years, there's another generation around. I mean, new babies get born and they grow up and parents show it to them. That accounts for some of its longevity, at least.
It's
beautiful.
A true story.
Yes.
But it's also a fairy tale, isn't it? It has those archetypes. And is that
and
also...
it's a rattling good adventure, if you think about
That's
it.
That's true.
Yes.
Yes.
Why doesn't Father turn the motor on?
Because he doesn't want anyone to hear us.
Oscar Hammerstein said collaboration is everything. And you were talking to me earlier today about the fact that Ernest Lehman had sort of the conception of you'll hear the wind and the sound of the wind becoming the flutes.
But for then the opening.
But then Erwin Costell.
Yes. Erwin Costell was the brilliant conductor and arranger of all the music, and he made all those notes come to life. So you heard the strings and the birds singing with the flute and so on. It was beautiful. Every single member, behind the scenes, in front of the camera, all of them were at the peak of their talents. Mm-hmm. I mean, literally, all the craftsmen.
Yes.
And our wonderful Ted McCord, who was the cinematographer, and Boris Levin, who did the most beautiful designs.
Right.
And Dorothy Jeekins did the costumes. Right. And they were spectacular. They made me feel like Maria, they did. And that wedding gown, wedding gown felt special, really special. But then that incredibly funny dress that I wear at the beginning of the piece.
When we enter the abbey, our worldly clothes are given to the poor.
And what about this one?
Well, the poor didn't want this one.
The poor didn't want this one. And it was so wonderfully bad.
And isn't there a wonderful, wonderful piece of trivia that late in the first half of the film, when Maria comes back in to see the Mother Abbess, there is a new postulant. And when Maria returns to the Von Trapp, she's wearing the...
You're right. It was very clever.
Oh, children, I'm so glad to see you.
We missed you.
Oh, I missed you.
Looking at the history, looking at sort of the dates, you and Chris Plummer finished your filming on Sound of Music in the middle of August of 64. 2 weeks later, you went to Grauman's Chinese Theater for the premiere of Mary Poppins.
That's right.
You went to the opening of Sound of Music, and a month later won your Academy Award for Mary Poppins.
I know.
So these two films catapulted you from a Broadway star.
From a very small fish in the Broadway pool to something that was quite, well, it really did sort of rattle my brains for a while. It's a lot, that kind of onslaught of press suddenly needing interviews. I mean, there wasn't a day for a while.
Was it difficult?
It, yes.
Because Broadway, you were a big Broadway star.
Yes.
With My Fair Lady with
No, I thank God my mom and my dad and brothers had kind of put me in my place when I was younger, because my mom always said to me, don't you dare get a swollen head. Mm-hmm. And one could easily have done that.
I like calling you mother.
I like hearing it.
The children in the film, were you sometimes a mother figure to them, or you were a governess?
I do know that whatever I could do, I did do to help get a capture a wonderful close-up or something like that. I remember sweet Dwayne Chase. I would do everything I could to make those eyes of his just sparkle and do something really funny or silly off camera. I remain friends with all the kids, actually, to this day.
And
we did
you...
bond. Yeah, yeah.
How did that...
But I think the music was the key to that. It infused us all, I think. It certainly did me.
When you were here in Salzburg and there were weather delays and all sorts of
things. Yes,
for the adults, it must have been taxing. But what about for the children? And were you...
Well, not only that, but the children had school. They had to do 4.5 hours of schooling every day and long days. That's a lot to ask of a child. And being in the fresh air somehow is quite exhausting. You're out there all day in sun, if you're lucky. And I think they must have gotten very, very tired.
You can tell us now, did they ever have meltdowns, or
honestly, that I recall, I never saw a meltdown. I don't recall a single one. And that really says
That's
something,
remarkable.
Yeah. They were happy when they, it seems, coming to work. Maybe it was because they were getting away from school.
Well,
but I think it was because they were going to have a wonderful time. Honestly, just seeing Salzburg again 50 years later, it hasn't really changed. It's just as beautiful. The thing that I love here is the sound of the bells. It's those wonderful chimes. And wherever you look, there's a vista.
Gorgeous.
Yeah.
Well, one thing has changed, which is 50 years ago, there weren't Sound of Music fans all over Salzburg.
Well, that's true. That's true. And I guess they've brought a lot of revenue to
and
the city.
Again, the genius of your filmmakers that they made Salzburg. I think you've said this. Salzburg is one of the characters of the film.
Yes, it is. You're absolutely right. But also, even the amount of rain that we had made those huge cumulus clouds pile up in the background when we were shooting, and it gave such strength to some of those beautiful shots right. in the film.
Do you think you've seen more of Salzburg this week than 50 years ago? Did you have a chance 50 years ago to sightsee?
That's a very good point, because we were so busy and things were going around in my head, like remembering my lines and learning how to play the guitar and being with my own lovely baby. There was never a moment that I could actually sit back and enjoy for myself
right.
as a tourist.
Right. So this week, has that
so
been
this
fun?
Week
you've
I've
been
put
a tourist
right.
a bit.
Yes,
I have.
I took a boat ride on the river for myself and tried to remember where did we run along the edge of the river
right.
and which piece of that river was it, and I found it.
Being in Salzburg, sometimes do you feel as if you've jumped inside the film? Because the film is
yeah.
so iconic in
yeah.
how it captures. And I think that's what draws visitors here. People want that connection with the film.
I had forgotten, though, how small a city this is.
Oh,
it's not a sprawling,
no.
large city, and it's all the more beautiful for
yes.
that. You can grasp it quickly, and every corner that you turn,
yes.
there's something beautiful to see.
It's a gorgeous
yeah.
city. And you walk through the Mirabel Gardens, and there are people singing Do Re Mi, and there are people singing my favorite.
And going
things,
around the fountain.
Going around the fountain, yes. or they're doing their pose. They're
yes,
doing
or
pose.
They're up on the mountain doing the great twirl.
Right, right. Filming the iconic opening scene, could you have had the sense that that moment is one of the most famous moments in cinematic history?
No, and I'm thrilled that it was. But
you
know,
it catches you every time.
You stand out there on the mountain and you hear those huge speakers blasting away so that you'll hear it, the complete huge symphony orchestra at you. Well, I defy anybody not to be thrilled.
Right. Do you remember the first time you saw a chunk of the movie or a sequence of the movie and you really thought, this is...
The very first time I saw it, I was so stunned that watching everything
of
that
course,
we had shot, especially, well, so much had to match and so much
yes.
was filmed back on the Hollywood sound
yes,
stages
right.
as well. Anything indoors was mostly in Hollywood.
Right.
And then all the exteriors, of course, were here.
Good evening.
The one screening I do remember is the one when I was dating my future husband of 41 years, Blake Edwards, and I met his kids.
Mm.
And I met Jennifer and Jeffrey, and I arranged that day for a screening. Bob very kindly let me have a private screening of the film just for them. And when the intermission came around, I had a big old picnic on the screening room floor for them.
Oh.
We all sat down and then we went back to our seats and watched the second half of the movie.
Oh, my.
Yeah, lucky me. Follow that, other stepmoms, you know.
Exactly.
Well, well, well.
You know what? The film sort of puts its kind arm around children and doesn't make them feel quite as lonely, because there is a family they can identify with. And maybe it's a small substitute for children that don't have a home or who need to learn about what a family is like and what is loving and kind.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's something there.
Something good.
Something good for anybody that cares to respond in a nice way, in a loving way, yeah. Like the Salzach River, which has flowed through this city for some 13 centuries, the connection between Salzburg and the Sound of Music is both constant and ever-changing. And its story remains as relevant as ever in a world still shadowed by cruelty and prejudice and war, but also enriched by simple acts of tremendous courage. I'm often asked why our film has resonated for so long. Well, I think it's certainly because of the glorious songs of Rodgers and Hammerstein, and for sure, the sights and sounds of beautiful Salzburg. But I also think it's because the film is about family and children. It's about music and mountains and the real joy that all of us felt while making it. And after 50 years, I still say to myself, how lucky can a girl get to have been a part of it all?